Whenever you want to start the meeting, you can go ahead and do that.
So this is the Easthampton Affordable and Fair Housing Partnership. It is Thursday, November 12th at 6:03 p.m. Welcome, everyone. We have three times as many members or people on the meeting than usual, so it's nice to see some other faces. Should we do introductions? Everyone's on mute but me, which it makes me feel really weird.
I'm Chris Korchek. I'm from EDIC, and I'm excited to see this report.
Tom Brown, EDIC.
Tom.
Peg Conniff, City Council.
Dan Riff, City Council.
Lindsay Rothschild, City Council.
Tom Peake, City Council.
And I'm Jeff Begg, I'm the city planner.
I'm Jana Tatro, I'm the chair of the Housing Partnership.
I'm Jamie Webb, I'm the assistant planner.
I'm Yoshi Bird, I am Jackie's neighbor, and also I've worked in housing and homelessness for about 20 years, so I think that's why she invited me.
Kate or Brad, do you want to introduce yourself?
Yep, I'm Brad Riley, also a member of the Housing Partnership.
And I think Kate might be temporarily frozen. Okay, well, welcome everyone. Welcome Judy Barrett, our consultant that hired from the city. She's gonna give us an update on the housing production plan. I think hopefully most people saw the draft that was circulated prior to the meeting and maybe had a chance to look at it. So our agenda, the only thing ahead of Judy on the agenda was review of the meeting minutes from September. So we can just defer that to afterwards. So we maximize the amount of time that we have with Judy. And take it away.
Super. All right. So I will now rely on screen share here. Here we go. So it's been quite a day. I have done screen share on GoToMeeting on Microsoft Teams and on Zoom. So I'm slowly becoming proficient in all these crazy platforms, and they all work a little bit differently. Oh, and there was a WebEx meeting thrown in the middle too. So the last time I spoke with you guys, we talked a lot about the housing needs that we were seeing as we look at the data. And what I thought would be helpful tonight would be to talk about really what is the heart of this plan and every housing plan I've ever worked on, which is really sort of what are you trying to do, what do you need to do, and how are you going to get there? So I organize these slides around the goals and the strategies. We can certainly get into needs as much as you want. I can kind of go back into the report and pull things out if you wish. But I thought just in the interest of time, maybe we should jump into this and then also talk about kind of what the next steps are for the process. So if that's okay with you, that's where I'm going to jump to. So there are, as you know, like five goals in the plan. So DHCD requires that every housing production plan have three key components. One is a needs assessment, which is much of what we talked about the last time I saw you. And then a section on goals, which are both qualitative and quantitative. So the quantitative goals are around what number of units would you need to produce if you wanted to have a certified housing plan. And as I think you probably all understand, right now we're still working with numbers that are based on Census 2010. Those numbers will eventually change. I wouldn't get too shaken up about it. The number's not going to change for a little while. But for now, we have to go with what we have. So we have to think about how do we work towards certification as we're trying to get toward the 10% statutory minimum under 40B. But the other part of the goals are qualitative. It's kind of what kind of housing would you like to see? What kind of needs are most important to you to consider? So the goals are kind of lofty and aspirational, but I think that's fine. That's sort of, I think, what the state wants communities to do. So the first goal that's in the plan is creating a wide variety of affordable and mixed income housing that helps to keep the community welcoming and inclusive. So we talk throughout the plan about the needs for kind of a range of housing types and making it as flexible as possible to produce that kind of housing. Thinking about the housing options, not only for affordability, but also market rate development, because ultimately one of the things you need to be thinking about is just boosting supply. And I don't happen to be a believer in the idea that somehow if you just boost supply, you bring prices down. But I mean, it does help, certainly. And I think that that sometimes some communities I've worked in are so focused on the 10% that they sort of forget about the bigger needs of the community. So we kind of thought this was an important thing for Easthampton, and it's certainly consistent with what I heard when we did interviews, you know, many months ago. So thinking about housing options for seniors, for young families, for people with disabilities, and making the, providing a range within you know, different types of housing types for those populations. And the third goal is working toward the 10% minimum, which, you know, really is kind of the point of an HPP. So DHCD would want to see this in the plan. Even if you don't expect to get to 10% in 5 years, it is part of the program. So thinking about how do we do that? And in your case, aiming for at least 38 units to get towards certification, you know, how do you do that? Well, that's all in the strategies that we're going to talk about in a little bit, but that's one of the goals. And then a fourth goal is thinking about both new development and repurposing of existing buildings, which fortunately you have opportunities to do in Easthampton. Some communities I work in don't have a lot of realistic options for repurposing existing properties. You do. And that makes actually this plan kind of fun in a way. But thinking about how you do that and then kind of reinforce the principles in your master plan and your downtown plan. How do you bring all those pieces together so that you address not only housing needs, but also the city's need to support downtown development, to you know, to perhaps provide more protection for outlying areas, bring people close to goods and services. These things actually can work together. So that's sort of what the fourth goal looks to. And then the fifth goal is developing kind of institutional surplus property to be able to provide more affordability. And again, you know, you guys are really sort of so ideally positioned to address some of these things that it's that it makes this plan kind of interesting. So you have opportunities that I'm going to talk about more in a minute, but you already know what they are, to be able to use existing municipal property or simply, you know, institutional or property that was built for commercial and industrial purposes that's no longer, it's sort of obsolete for some of those purposes. And how do you use those assets to create more affordability and to create more supply? So those are kind of the four overarching goals of the plan. I think that they're not a surprise, but I think they're appropriate for Easthampton. This is where this gets to be kind of really fun to talk about is sort of now what are you going to do? You kind of have these goals and how are you actually going to get there? And I, in talking to Jeff over the last several months, Jeff and Jamie both, you know, in some ways, I feel like the housing production plan regulations were written for Easthampton because you guys have opportunities to address every single one of the required strategies that DHCD lays out in the housing production plan regulations. And that's not always the case. Sometimes we are really reaching to find ways to say, well, the town could do this or the town could do that. But you guys kind of hit all the, you hit everything, which is good. And what that tells me as a planner is, you know, you're poised well, I think, to be able to address the whole variety of housing needs that exist in the city because you have the assets and frankly, the brains to figure this out. So the first strategy, DHCD lays out basically five key strategies and each one of these has to have some attention in the plan. So the first one is, what are you gonna do about your zoning? We always sort of put it on the community to say, what can you do? The assumption, of course, being that zoning itself, to some extent, is a specific barrier to housing production. So we just have these sort of overarching things, and some of these will show up in more than one strategy area, but looking at ways to streamline the approval process for multifamily development, looking at the possibility of two-family dwellings as of right in all districts, and removing barriers to accessory apartments. So those are kind of umbrella things. But then we go on and we talk about, you know, thanks to input from Jeff and Jamie, kind of looking at some very specific district issues in all of these districts. In the highway business district, we have, you know, the ability to do multifamily, and but multifamily with affordable by special permit. And the idea is, why do you need the special permit? Because you really don't. You could actually liberate that multifamily provision with affordable units from a special permit requirement and provide that that extra kind of guarantee or reliability that the development community is looking for in order to take the risk to create, you know, the affordable units. And then looking at the, you know, the mill district and how do you make that perhaps, you know, more of an incentive for people to use that, looking at ways to kind of address what may be some limitations in your downtown smart growth overlay district and business districts are, you know, business district and R5. These things are also talked about in your downtown plan. So I don't want to, you know, get into a whole discussion about this, but these are things that also are consistent with another plan in your town. So I would point out that when you talk about these things that you can do with your zoning, an particular asset in this plan is, and oh, by the way, we're also trying to address these things for other reasons. And so that, again, kind of makes it a stronger plan because it's not just about the affordable housing plan. So thinking about, you know, how do you express the density in the smart growth overlay district, kind of making it clear that it's a minimum of 20, et cetera. These are things that you can do going into your own zoning and in some ways making fundamental changes and in other cases making tweaks. My point is you have several opportunities that you can say to DHCD, there are zoning things we can do without relying on comprehensive permits or anything else. These are all things that we could do. And some of these ideas are actually in our scope to kind of help the city sort of lay out, like, how would you do this? And, you know, and a good example is the accessory apartment ordinance, which we'll get to in a bit. But these are all the sort of zoning district ways that you can look at making your zoning more, I guess I would call it affordable housing friendly. Let me go on to the next slide. So the next strategy, the second one that DHCD requires you to address is, you know, identifying specific sites where you would encourage the filing of comp permits. And I had a little anxiety about putting these locations, as Jeff will tell you. I was a little bit nervous about this, and not because I think it's a bad idea to actually name places, but many communities I've worked in have been reluctant to name sites because they were concerned about setting off expectations with private property owners about, you know, well, what could my land actually be if it's going to be become a comp permit? But the reality is most, if not all of these were listed in the previous plan. So the cat is already out of the bag in a way. But the other thing is that it just makes it clear that there are certain places where it would be okay. And so these are particular properties that are mentioned in the plan. And some of these are properties that also happen to be in the site studies that Dodson and Flinker are doing. So let me just stop for a minute and remind everybody that this team includes two consultants. We're working on the housing production plan and the sort of, you know, the layout of the housing element of your master plan. And Dodson and Flinker are doing these particular kind of site studies about, well, here's four sites that you could do something with in your community. What are the possibilities? And those were the inserts in the appendix at the end of the plan, which, you know, we're trying to kind of get you a little bit better, a more print-friendly format of those. Dodson and Flinker is pretty much finished up at this point, kind of a write-up of what those different scenarios will be for the four site studies they've worked on. But all of that helps to enrich this plan because it says to DHCD, we didn't just sort of throw a dart at a dartboard and say, well, these properties would be okay. We actually have gone as far as to look at some of these and say, what could be done on these sites and what are the different possibilities? Because there's probably more than one way to do housing affordability on some of these sites. So these are sites that are mentioned. You guys may have some to suggest that we did not include, but this is what the plan says right now. Another required action is kind of a, what do you want? You know, so this is getting a little bit more like qualitative. It's what kind of housing would you want to see? And DHCD encourages communities to think about this so that when developers come to your community, perhaps looking for a way to do affordable or mixed income housing, they have some idea of what it is that the community wants. So one of the things that seemed kind of obvious to me anyway, just looking at the housing stock and the development pattern in the community, is make it a little easier to do two-family dwellings. You know, everything about our state zoning act intends to treat two-family and single-family dwellings the same way. And yet communities don't. And I think you might want to think about whether there are ways to liberate two-family dwellings from whatever the restrictions are on them so that it's a little easier to create them. But one way to do it, in addition to just allowing them as a right, is to think about the possibility of perhaps allowing some on non-conforming lots. And by that, I mean a lot that might otherwise not be buildable. But if it has access to sewer and it can therefore support a little bit of density, then maybe think about getting two units on a lot. And you know, it may not be palatable to a developer who wants to do mixed income housing, but for a housing trust or a housing nonprofit that's looking for opportunities to do small scale development, those kinds of situations can be very meaningful. And in a lot of the communities I've worked in Western and Eastern Massachusetts, it's those small lots that really on an incremental basis create additional housing opportunities without elevating everybody's anxiety about scale and density. So something to think about. And then, some of these kind of repeat, but it's to make them self-reinforcing. This idea of allowing multifamily as of right if it includes affordable units. And that's something I think you really want to take a look at. You know, the oldest affordable housing ordinances in Massachusetts that I know, which are Cambridge, Brookline, Newton, and Somerville, all at one time required a special permit for affordable housing. And some of them still do. But the movement is away from that because there's really no requirement to require, there's no reason to require the special permit, even if you're giving additional density. You just have to write the zoning so it's clear. And so there's a public benefit served in providing that density. So these are things I think you're really going to want to think about. Another required action that you have to address, when I say required action, I mean these are categories DHCD requires you to think about. So another one is, where have you got municipally owned property that you could do a request for proposals on and perhaps do some affordable housing? Like I said, you kind of hit all the boxes on these required actions because you're in the middle of a school project that's going to allow you, if you choose, to make school properties available for affordable housing. You know, not this year, maybe not in 2021, but in the lifetime of this plan, that opportunity exists. And that's exactly the kind of answer that you should give. And it's probably the most important and most appropriate one that you have in your community. There may be others, but this one's an obvious one. And I think you want to make it clear to the state that that is the plan. And then the last required action is a little bit strange. You know, in some parts of the state, we have like regional housing consortia. Get out into Western Mass and you don't find that quite so much, but nonetheless, the state wants you to address how you're going to participate with regional entities to create affordable housing. Again, I think you have existing partnerships out there that you can identify because you've worked with them before, Valley CDC, you know, and HAP. Has HAP changed its name recently?
Yes, to Wayfinders.
Thank you. Yes. I will correct that. Thank you very much. So that's one example. You guys have already worked with those organizations before. But another thing I thought I would just mention is, you know, CHAPA has a new program. It's new, about 2 years old. It's their municipal engagement program. And what they do is they go into a community with a staff person and kind of provide intensive technical support to build a base of advocacy for affordable housing, and not just kind of increase the number of people who say I support affordable housing, but actually increasing the capacity of the community through those advocates to effect change. And it's been the communities I know that have participated feel that they've all gotten something out of it. I happen to be working on a plan in Acton at the same time that CHAPA was using Acton as a pilot community for this program. And they're out of Acton at this point. They've moved on to other communities, but that core group that CHAPA helped to build up is it's in place, it's active, it's involved. And what it did is it took the heat off a fairly small, influential, but small group of affordable housing advocates and gave them more clout and increased the number of people who kind of understood the issue and understood kind of how to be effective advocates. So, you know, the idea that maybe doing something regionally, you know, two communities together might be very interesting to CHAPA. Not that you shouldn't go after it yourselves, but again, thinking in terms of regional coalitions, it might be interesting to think about doing it with a neighboring community. So those are the strategies that are recommended in the draft plan. And you know, there may be others that you want me to talk about that I didn't. But I can tell you that the ones that are in that draft right now will all be acceptable to DHCD. So we haven't missed anything that they're looking for. Now, that's not the only thing one tries to do in one of these plans. It's not just to sort of get a document that DHCD blesses. It's also something you can do and you can live with. And that's why the comments are so important to me, because I could have missed something. You know, I'm never going to know your community as well as you do. So if I've missed something that you think is important, I want to know so I can address it. But that's really the overview. The heart of the plan is these goals and the strategies. And I'm on questions now, so I made it pretty well here if I actually got to this point.
Thank you. I mean, I think this is fascinating information, and I'm always, you know, I love the data, and then I love planning for what we're going to do next. I think what I mean, so our last housing production plan had probably an unrealistic and like unwieldy list of to-do items, action items. But I will say that that has served the housing partnership really well, having those action items, kind of being able to pick out ones that we thought we could be successful in. So I think one thing that I feel like I'd like to have included is some type of action item, and perhaps the last plan also included like who was responsible for those things. So, you know, some things the city council has to do, some things, you know, the CPA committee has to do, some things the, you know, mayor's office has to do, some things the housing partnership has to do. So it just helps us kind of frame like where we're, how to get there.
We do that for all the master plans and comprehensive plans we do. So we certainly could do that as well. Okay. That may be something, Jeff, you actually asked me to do, and somehow it sort of went off my radar screen, but we can do that.
I think that'd be really helpful. I think, you know, as how do we,
I did have a little concern about your last plan. It was funny. I remember I talked to Jeff and I think Jamie, I think both of you were on the call, that, a struggle I have as a planner is always, do you give a community a plan that has sort of everything in it, but the kitchen sink? Or do you give them a very kind of focused sort of, these are things that you can do. And I wrestle with that, just, you know, laying my cards on the table with you. I wrestle with that myself because I've been hired in some communities that just finished a housing plan and it's got all this stuff in it and they don't know where to begin. Mm-hmm. So the other school of thought is you sort of narrow the list of things to things that you think can actually be done, because then when the community's evaluating the plan in 5 years, they could say, oh my God, look at all the stuff we got done. This is your plan. So if you kind of err on the side of everything with the kitchen sink and also tell us who should be doing what, that's fine. I don't mind doing that. I just want you to know why I didn't.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like finding a happy medium between like, you know, five really big things to do. And I think we had, I don't know, 48 things to do from the last plan is helpful.
Okay. That's fine.
And I think along those lines, if we, I don't know if we've gone through the required actions from the previous plan, but just seeing where we've, what we've done and what we have left to do. Again, and maybe there are some of those that are higher priority going forward, that we want to, like Jen is saying, to carry forward again.
That's fine.
I mean, I'll just keep talking unless someone else is going to say something.
What about you?
I had a very specific question, which was, and if Jamie and Jeff know this, but your recommendation, because it's such a specific action plan about the duplexes with the non-conforming lots, I don't see somewhere in Jeff and Jamie. Do you know how to address that in zoning?
I do.
I don't, and that's why I'm asking you specifically, because I don't, it's an interesting idea, and I don't know the answer. So Jeff and Jamie, if you know what she's talking about, that's great. But since I don't, while we have Judy here, I just wanted to ask about it for a moment.
Yeah.
I was going to say, why don't we let Judy give a little bit of that explanation, and then we'll see where that goes. I think I'm kind of curious how Judy answers that, too.
You would need a provision in your zoning ordinance, you know, call it, for the sake of this discussion, you know, affordable housing on small lots. Call it whatever you want. And you lay out kind of what the requirements are, notwithstanding the provisions of X, which is the dimensional table. You know, the following will be allowed in the following districts. On lots of, you know, say 5,000 square feet or whatever the minimum is, drop it down, or simply eliminate it and say, you know, notwithstanding the provisions of the other sections, the you know, two-family dwellings will be allowed on any lot in the following districts without regard to minimum lot area, provided the lot has 50 feet of frontage, or something that simple. And then, of course, you want to have the rules around. What does affordable mean and how do they count and all that stuff? But all you need to do is make it clear that you're essentially granting a waiver in the zoning bylaw in the interest of a public benefit, which happens to be the two family dwelling. It's really that simple. And you would not be the first community that had done that. Not many have, but it is certainly, it's possible to do. A lot of towns have done that for single family dwellings, but they are towns that don't have sewer. So if you have sewer, you've made the Title V problem go away. So why not think about an efficient way to use the land that you have? My view about so much about getting housing built is you have to make land. And the ways that communities remove land is through regulation. So you also can use regulation to make land. And being creative about thinking about ways that you can do that is fine.
Judy, under that issue of regulation, and I apologize if I'm getting off on a little bit of a tangent here, but at the last presentation, you had a slide about the number of pages in our zoning regulations with the word wow after it or something to that effect.
Yes.
And tonight you've mentioned some possible enhancements to zoning to allow more units or affordable or what have you. I guess I don't know where we go, as a city with our current zoning. My fear is with some of these potential changes, it becomes more pages. And how do we, I know Jeff has mentioned in the past that might be another whole issue of getting zoning redone, but what's a normal size zoning plan for a city like ours, and how do we get there?
You know, I don't think it's just the length. It's really the multiplicity of provisions, the duplication, there's inconsistency. I mean, I could go on and on. In a housing plan, the fact is we have to address zoning because DHCD requires you to address it. If you want me to take my housing production plan hat off and speak to you as a planner, I'd say, if I were you guys, I'd be recodifying that zoning bylaw, because I think there's a lot of cleanup that you could do to make it a simpler document to work with. Just the sheer number of special permit kind of fallbacks that you have really ought to be looked at. But I also found, and I wish I could think of an example right now, I can't because I don't have the zoning open, but I remember looking through it and thinking, my God, there's just inconsistencies in terms of the way words are used in this ordinance. And you know why that happens? It's not because people are incompetent. It's because over time, communities try to make their zoning better. So one year, it's this voice writing an amendment, and the next year, it's this voice writing an amendment. And all of a sudden, over, say, 10 years, you have these different voices that have come into the document, and they're using words a little bit differently, and they're using phrasing a little bit differently. And that's when we start to see inconsistencies in a zoning ordinance. So I think really what you want to do is clean up the ordinance. But these are things that you can do that I don't think are going to add length. In some ways, they may even make it simpler.
Okay.
Hey, Judy, I have a question. You say that we can create land by regulation through the zoning. How have communities that you've worked with reacted to that, you know, on the citizen level? Have there been a lot of backlash to that?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. Is this a CHAPA thing that you would recommend to get
the municipal engagement program? I just think they're really good at helping communities build a broad base. You know, mm-hmm. it really is the whole point of the program. If you think about any public hearing you've been to, where the neighborhood shows up and they're motivated. I mean, they're angry. They don't want change. The problem is there's often nobody there to counter that. And so part of this program is just about how do you build the confidence of people to go to a ZBA or a planning board hearing or a city council hearing and say, I support this because. It's kind of hard when you're the special permit granting authority to respond when there's nobody saying that. Now, the fact is that as a special permit granting authority, you ought to be guided by the criteria in your ordinance and not just by what people are saying. But I don't know how many of you have been on the ZBA or planning board, but I happen to be on the ZBA in my own town. I got to tell you, it's hell. So just building a base of people who have a confidence to go to a board and say, this is a good idea because, or, you know, this is a great idea. I think it could even be better if they did X, Y, and Z, but to be constructive, to have that as a permitting person, to have that offsetting the negativity is valuable. People often don't want change and they're afraid of it. And then, you know, when it finally happens in their backyard, they really don't like it. I think that if nothing else, things like what you're doing with this plan and really even things like cleaning up your zoning ordinance, things that you did with your downtown plan, you're continuing to try to do. Sometimes really the underlying objective is to equip your decision makers to make the best decisions they can within the framework of the ordinance and perhaps be more allegiant to that than the noise in the room. It's not easy. I'm not gonna tell you it is.
So Judy, first I wanted to say thank you for all your hard work on this. You know, the report looks really fantastic. I love a lot of the projects that are on there. I think they're totally doable. So I have two questions for you. I guess it's one question with two parts. So you said earlier that the housing plan numbers currently are based off the 2010 census numbers.
Yeah.
So when the 2020 numbers come out, do you anticipate that the number of units per year is going to go up or go down? And, you know, first, could you just kind of give me like your professional projection on what you think those numbers would be?
So I did not attempt to do that projection because I wasn't confident that I had all the information I would need to do that. And that's not a comment about the city staff. It's just, it's a discomforting projection to make. My sense is the number will probably go up.
Yeah.
I don't know why it would go down.
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. The only areas I know of where I think that number might go down are the Cape and the Islands of Nantucket, and maybe even South Berkshire County, because what's happening in those regions is that the demand for seasonal housing is overwhelming the supply. So not only is all the new stuff being geared toward the seasonal market, but what was traditionally year-round housing is getting absorbed by the seasonal market as well. And bear in mind that the way the calculation for 40B is done, it's 10% of your year-round housing units. So whatever seasonal comes off the top, okay. Those places may see actually a reduction in the number of units they need to get to 10%. In Nantucket's case, it's possible they'll even get over 10%.
Okay, great. And then, so the second part of that question is, in terms of all of the projects that you've laid out, is it possible for us to still meet all of the goals that we have set out without utilizing the Irving Street development? And I have a specific follow-up to that. And really what it comes down to is, so several years ago in our community, there was a microburst that hit Mount Tom.
Yes, right.
And the Irving Street area where this proposed development is, most of the animals that were up on the top of Mount Tom were dislocated, and they now live in the woods here in the center of the town. I feel that the owners of the property will not take good ecological care when the development starts. So my concern with this project is what we would be doing with, you know, the bears and the rabbits and, you know, all of the birds and other different animals that live in this area. because they kind of feed into the general ecosystem around the Oxbow, the Connecticut River, and Mill Pond. And I just worry that if we remove that forest area, that it's going to severely disrupt the ecological community. So I guess that was my question, is it possible for us to still meet all of those goals without removing the forest from the Irving Street area?
Without commenting on the Irving Street project, just not commenting on the merits of it. It seems to me as though there are enough tools in the toolbox here that you have ways to get to at least a certification goal and continue to work toward 10% without any particular one project. I mean, the school projects alone could make significant headway for you. So, I mean, that would be my answer. You know, I feel for communities that have that kind of concern. And again, I'm not commenting on the merits of the project at all, but if you think about what is within the realm of the ZBA when a project comes to them under Chapter 40B, there are specific local concerns they can consider and a lot of other ones they can't. Environmental impact is one of them, but you got to have a really sort of airtight case. And then ultimately the board has to sit there and say, does this environmental need outweigh the regional need for affordable housing? Is this local concern that much more important than this? And the difficulty when you're under 10% is the way the law sort of works is that if you're not at 10% or over, then almost anything else that is a valid local concern becomes a real reach to defend. So, you know, I guess I would say if you have a particular concern about preservation in a particular part of town, seems to me as though that would be a good reason to try to move some of these other ideas forward. That's probably the best answer I can give you.
Nope, that's perfect. Thank you, Judy. I appreciate it.
And can I just add also that the properties are privately owned, so should it not come to the ZBA for a special permit for or a comprehensive permit, they could still, those properties could still be developed as single family homes under the ordinance, typically by right. So not developing it for affordable housing doesn't necessarily save that woodland.
That's a good point. Thank you, Jamie.
Councillor Peake, you have your hand up.
Thanks, Shannon. So yeah, this has all been super interesting. I guess my question is about what other deliverables should we as the council be expecting as sort of a part of this project? Because I remember when we appropriated funds to do the study, and my understanding was that there was going to be certainly like sort of a model zoning amendment about around ADUs and potentially some review of our zoning, including, I know that when we, the last time that we all sat in a room in person, there was some concerns you had brought up about potentially some legal issues in our zoning that I certainly think we'd want to all get within, get in compliance with pretty soon. You know, it's now November. I was expecting to actually have all of this in hand to start sort of moving it forward well before this. And so I'm just sort of curious beyond what's in this report, which is certainly very interesting and has a lot of actionable items that I think the council can respond to. I'm wondering what else we're going to get and when we can expect it.
So the one of our scope tasks is a suggested approach to ADUs that would be on an as-of-right basis. And Dodson and Flinker is going to give us, I think, some suggested design standards for that. I will be writing the ordinance or the draft ordinance. The other piece that's important to our work is what Dodson and Flinker is doing, which is they have looked at four sites that that we worked out with the city staff around here's some potential places where development could occur. And what are the possibilities for that? And they have kind of done the conceptual plans for that. I don't have their write-up yet. I spoke with Peter Flinker a couple of weeks ago. We're supposed to have that. I'm going to add that to this plan. Jeff, you and I should probably talk about this, but my plan was to add it so that people understand what those conceptuals are, the schematics are in the back of the plan. So that's a whole product line of trying to get people to think about the ways in which housing could be developed other than kind of the traditional system. And the third thing that I'm recalling that we're doing, and Jeff and Jamie, jump in if my brain is dead, is sort of the outline of what the next housing element of the master plan would be. You know, what are the issues that needs to address? So I think that's the other piece of this, is sort of, here's a housing production plan, but a housing element of a master plan is a little more than that. It's not just about affordability in the state regulations. It's really about housing and residential development and sort of the overall, how does housing fit within the larger goals of your community? So those are the pieces that I think we are still left to do. Am I right about that, Jeff? Am I forgetting something? I don't think so, but.
The only thing that's probably a little bit nuanced is, I think with looking ahead and kind of the master plan idea and market rate was just a little, I think we did talk about a little bit more on just barriers to housing development and just, I guess, either identifying what the barriers are or coming up with the possible solutions. And we're starting to see that. So I think, like the example that you described as making the multifamily by plan approval, you know, that's certainly something that, you know, I would encourage, you know, people like Councillor Peake, that's something that would be a tangible to-do list thing. And then I think another kind of barrier is, in just articulating it, is the example of the duplexes on a non-conforming lot. And if there's just a little bit of a list of barriers that we could potentially consider removing, whether and maybe on a list or through the next couple of years. I think that was, and I think that comes through all of this. I think it's just part of each of the steps that you do.
So I think one of the things that will be helpful to us would be, for example, on the not the duplex on non-conforming lot. I mean, that's something we can draft for you. Now, you're probably gonna wanna tweak it, but we can draft that. We certainly are gonna draft the accessory dwelling ordinance. I think, you know, we can certainly give you the write-up of the issues in the zoning bylaw. I mean, I did talk about them at the last meeting, and there's a lot of them. But I think that my concern, now with my planner hat on, set the housing plan aside for a minute, is I think there's other stuff in the zoning that needs to be looked at, which really is not kind of in our scope, but I'm happy to just give you at least a list. I just don't know that we can really do a whole, significant analysis of it. But there's stuff in your bylaw that needs to go. It's either not, these things are not consistent with Chapter 48, the Zoning Act, or it's just obsolete. So I can certainly identify those things. If my scope included a full zoning diagnostic, then I would do that. But really, this is sort of focused on housing.
Yeah, I think if you're focused on the housing part of it, I think that's where we are for this element of it. And I appreciate what, Tom Brown is saying. Right. I think one of the key things that I have heard along the way over the past, 2 years is there are a lot of things in the zoning that we probably need to look at, and the idea of recodification, but that we might want to prioritize doing some targeting amendments for housing first, so that, because we're this far along, and that's what one of the key things is, are there a few key amendments that we could pursue that would make significant, changes and allow more housing, and then start talking about the recodification. And my worry about recodification is, at the end of the day, we might not get significant changes. It will clean it up. And that's important, but we want to focus on these housing changes first, I think, from what I've heard.
And that's a policy decision. That's entirely a policy decision for you guys. When I do major zoning revisions, soup to nuts, we always start with a zoning diagnostic and a recod, because there's just so much inconsistency in these ordinances and bylaws that you need to clean up in order to make the thing work better. What often happens with these incremental amendments over time is that things get added that sound really cool and they're neat and they're going to do something for housing or whatever, but they end up creating an inconsistency with some other provision that nobody even knows is there because it hasn't been exercised. So the cleanup is, in my opinion, the right thing to do. But if you have housing issues you need to address right away, then you address them and then you do a recod later, but it needs to be done. That I can tell you.
Hey, Judy, I just have a follow-up to what you said. Do you have a time frame for the ADU ordinance language?
Well, I figured that was probably what we were going to do next. I think we want to, am I right? We need to get this, you want to get this filed. So let me get this to you because I need to add the stuff from Dodson and Flinker, and I think you'll probably want that implementation chart with the who should be doing what. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how much more anybody wants us to add to this, but I would think we could just move next into the ADU bylaw. We could do that next month.
Cool, thanks.
I kind of know what it should say. I mean, I've written plenty of them, but what I need to do is find out what Dodson and Flinker is going to contribute to it.
So Judy, sorry, this is Kate Shapiro, and I just want to tell you, I think this is fabulous. I think you did a phenomenal job. I do think Jeff's comment about, you do have the suggestions, they're all in there, but in a list format might be very helpful if that would be possible. There's also one other tweak, and I didn't read this today, I read it yesterday, so it's not fresh in my mind. I know you talk about public transit. Sometimes when someone has a document, you're the expert, so it becomes kind of the expert opinion. You talk about transportation here, but there's not a... there's not a combination, there's nowhere where you analyze the connection between transportation and some of the districts that you're suggesting that we change the zoning for. And okay. I think that would, if you could add something to that effect, because I think that's also another reason why the Mill District would be a good location for development of affordable housing and changing the zoning. And the yep. same with the... So I don't know if you, obviously you'd have to agree with that, but I do think that is one of also the benefits that I didn't even know that we needed to change that particular thing. But that's really a high target area for low income because of the transportation in those areas.
Okay, that I can do. Thank you.
I have a question, Danvers City Council. You mentioned that I think the other organization you're working with is going to be looking at property that might be targeted for housing. And I'm curious, I always like maps. There's a lot of land I found out, privately owned, large tracts that might be on the market in the near future. And I'm just curious if in your studies, you're looking at those areas, properties in town besides the municipally owned property, but private property that we could make attractive to a developer by giving them incentives for affordable housing. And if they may, those properties might already be on a map that Jeff has, but I'm just curious if that's one of the things you mean by a list of targeted areas or targeted properties.
So Dodson and Flinker is looking at four sites.
Just four?
Okay. Yes, because their scope was to both assess kind of the opportunities and constraints, and then also some scenarios. So, you know, you can't do all that for a large number of sites on this budget, but we have four that we've focused on. And the idea, of course, is that if you take these different kinds of sites in different locations and think about what could be done, optimally, it informs the way you might think about similar sites in other locations. So that is part of the plan. And that whole study will be an appendix to the housing production plan.
Thank you. That helps, though. We would use it as a model for tracking on.
That's
how you get developers to do affordable housing, giving them bonuses or incentives of some kind. Thank you very much.
No problem.
One thing that I found lots of things fascinating. One thing that I found fascinating was just some of the family data. Nearly one third of the students in the Easthampton Public School come from low income families. I thought that was a really astounding number.
I think she just froze.
I think she did too.
This is one of those, Zoom moments that drives everybody crazy, but it's not that I'll pick up on it while she's trying to rescue her Zoom, but I actually do find this in a fair number of communities that the demographics of the children in the public schools are not always well aligned with the demographics of the city as a whole. And it can be for anything from the composition of families is simply different from the composition of the non-families to some people send their kids to private school there's any number of things that might contribute to that, but the schools certainly do identify in their demographic reports to the state a fairly high number of high need kids.
Judy, one other one other observation, if I might. Chris mentioned, you know, issues with neighbors when you make changes. I think you mentioned that, Chris. Brad mentioned, you know, environmental issues. Obviously, whenever there's change, there's a lot of competing forces. One that comes to mind with the new school, I mean, with the walking away from the existing schools is historical. And, you know, we've already got a couple of cases in Easthampton, and I don't want to dredge up the past too much, but where, you know, if something different had been done with older buildings, we would have had the potential for a lot more housing. So I guess my only point in that observation is if our focus is on housing, mm-hmm. and we can't just discredit everything else, we can't discredit environmental or historical or neighborhood issues, but I think we have to continue to just try to focus on what, is there a happier medium with the schools, with other downtown, even though they might be private properties, to get the most out of that development for housing as we can. And I'm probably only thinking of three competing forces. There's probably 10 when you put them all together. But Jana's group, I know, you know, you're focusing on housing, and hopefully as things like the schools come up for redevelopment, housing stays the primary focus.
I think one way, Tom, I'd like to add to that. I think one way to do it is making sure that the section that talks about the schools also focuses on the property and maybe not over, I mean, it's a balance. So maybe not overemphasizing the actual school building as what, you know, could happen, but more the property. And I think, Judy, I think I've said this to you, and I try to say it as much as possible, but we're in a super highly desirable situation, which is we have three school properties,
right?
Not just one. So a lot of communities have gone through the process of disposing of one elementary school, and they have all the competing interests on one property. We have three, so we have this really good opportunity to potentially sort of share or spread desirable uses across three properties. So just maybe not overemphasizing the actual school building.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Maybe that's one way to consider that. I have a bunch of like sort of small nitpicky things that I'll skip. But one of the questions that I have is about the difference between goal one and goal two. I have read them several times, and I have a hard time trying to figure out. I think it's a kind of a, oh man, my kids came into the room and it's really distracting me. There seems like a pretty nuanced difference between goal one and goal two. And I just want to understand your take on goal one and goal two. And then, because I'm not sure if it's related, one of the things that, you know, I'm hearing a lot about, and I think we're hearing a lot about as a community, is that the cost of living in Easthampton is going up. And what we have is we have several neighborhoods that I would describe as our most vulnerable. They're some of our oldest neighborhoods. So if you look around the mills, the historic development pattern of housing near the mills is one of our oldest neighborhoods. And I think by the nature of them, they are some of our most affordable dwelling units.
Yeah.
And what the mayor, you know, continues to ask me about is what kind of strategies could we use to keep those areas affordable to live in, not necessarily defined as with a capital A affordable housing, but make them, you know, make the rents stay as low as possible. And if there's some other mechanisms or strategies that we should also be employing. So maybe it's in the action list, or maybe it's like a goal, which is things we can do to protect some of those neighborhoods.
Existing affordability.
And yes. And I think it's going to be a really important thing for us, you know, over time to create new affordable units as one separate kind of bucket of actions, but also preserve, you know, it's not necessarily that they're capital A affordable, but they are affordable right now. And we want to, you know, look at some creative ways at keeping those rents stable. So those are I think I just rattled off a couple things, but.
So regulation is not going to get you there.
Right. So other alternatives, I think it'd be helpful with your expertise to help us lay out some potential options for the future of those neighborhoods.
So to answer your question about goal one and goal two, it's an important nuance. The first goal is around diversity, inclusion, and equity. The second goal is about a variety of household types.
Judy, I have another question that maybe I haven't looked through this close enough, but and maybe you can't recommend this, but in developing these, I'm just looking at the household inventory by units and structure. Do you have a recommendation for when we're developing, based on the numbers? I'm not like a great numbers person, if we should be targeting, you know, you talk a lot about having an aging population and a lot of an increase in single family, an increase in households because there's so many single families. Are you suggesting that we develop more, that we need more one bedrooms, family? I didn't see it in there. Maybe I missed it.
You know, truthfully, I was trying to wrestle with that myself because, you know, what's been happening demographically in your city, and you're not alone, is that as household growth has ensued, you have more non-family households now than family households. This is actually true in many of the, I would probably say most of the communities I've worked in, except perhaps some of the suburbs immediately west of Boston. So there is this trend here, and what it suggests is if you have a lot of non-family household formation taking place, single family dwellings may not be the best way to meet those needs. So, you know, I always think about housing as a product, right? So you think about yourself as a consumer, you buy certain things based on whatever your personal needs are. Well, you know, a single family home with four bedrooms is not necessarily something that is addressing a need of a non-family household. So we have this problem everywhere of a disconnect taking place between what the market hopes to God they can sell and what the households are actually kind of looking for. So I think it's another reason to be thinking about just diversity in household types. I'm always a little bit reluctant to get into a bedroom conversation because it's a slippery slope to a conversation about families with school-age children, which may not be a problem in your city, but it is a problem in every community I've worked in, that people underneath a lot of these conversations, there's race and there's schools. And I've learned to kind of just stay away from it because I don't think it's relevant. But I do think talking about smaller housing units for certain kinds of households while also preserving opportunities for families is probably a balanced way to think about addressing the needs of both. And not every family can afford a single family home in a new subdivision either. I mean, thinking about how do you provide three bedroom dwelling units in multifamily housing is just as important as single family homes in a subdivision.
Now that I'm not frozen, I will say that those are sort of the two things that really jumped out at me had to do with our aging population. And the age of our housing, but then also families and how we seem to be leaving them behind a little bit in our zoning. So, you know, one of the comments you made was about parking requirements, the excessive parking requirements that make it really challenging to build three bedroom units because you need four parking spaces per unit. Which is a, you know, or three or whatever it is. And again, just the number of school age children that live that are low income, number of families that live in poverty that are headed by a single female head of household. And so my question that I got cut off by froze last time just had to do with the homeless data and whether or not the school was able to provide any data about homeless families. You know, I know we don't have any shelters, but they would know if families were doubled up.
I don't think I have that, but we can ask.
Okay, I was just curious. I feel like it might round out that section about homelessness data, but also some of the data about families in poverty.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And we don't have that, but I can ask. I worked in another town up on the North Shore where that was exactly an issue. It was a huge issue, and they were in a regional school district, so they had two other towns that kind of looked down on them because they happened to have a lot of homeless kids in the third community that wasn't so wealthy. So we can ask for that. I appreciate that comment. Your parking requirements for multifamily housing are insane. And when I see that, what I see is at some point in that community, and I don't know when, somebody had a conversation about school-aged children, because that's the only time I ever see parking requirements tied to the number of bedrooms, is when there's been this conversation. It might have been 20 years ago, but there's no reason to require as much parking as you do for multifamily housing. Absolutely none.
Councillor Peake, do you have a comment about that?
He probably does. He probably wants to fire me right now. But.
Oh, no, quite to the contrary. I don't have a comment. I have a question. So that to me sounds like, you know, I'll just say this, and I said this the first time we met, and every time I've dropped in on one of you guys' meetings, and thank you for hosting me, is I feel a lot of pressure, and I think I can speak for, I think the other councillors do too. We feel a lot of pressure to do something about affordability. We have a lot of constituents who feel like their ability to remain in this community, or the ability for their next generation of their family to remain in this community, is seriously under threat. It's a serious concern, and it's something that I think we have struggled to figure out how to move on, because it's a technical issue and none of us really have the technical training. So parking requirements, by right, two families, like these are all things that I think you could get a pretty warm reception to for at least a majority of the council. But what I'm wondering is, like, is there, like, I'm looking at what's here in the report, and it says ease parking requirements for mixed use projects by adopting standards in the SGZD downtown mixed use. Like, so is there like technical, if I wanted to say, okay, we agree it's unreasonable, what do we change it to? Like, where do you even start with that?
Well, there are pretty good parking standards for multifamily and mixed use development. I mean, for one thing, on mixed use, you really can just use an averaging method if you want, but that gets into a kind of an argument sometimes about the discretion and interpretation by the board. Averaging meaning I have X percentage of space for retail and X percentage for housing. And so I come up with an average between the two requirements. But really, you can just drop the requirements and you can say for multifamily housing, you know, for studio and one bedroom units, it's one parking space. And for anything two bedrooms or over, it's 1.5 or something like that. I mean, if I were in a city that had a lot of public transportation, I wouldn't even be saying that. But I think in communities that don't have public transportation routes everywhere, you have to kind of be realistic. So I would say 1.5 spaces for multifamily and for the residential units in mixed use. And give the permitting authority the ability to drop that through what's called reserve parking. So say someone can come to you and make a case that I don't really need that many parking spaces for this project. And the site plan review authority says, well, but it is required in the zoning. The agreement is fine. You got a place on the site plan that says, this is where these parking spaces are gonna go, but I don't have to build them right away. I'm gonna prove to you I don't really need them. I'm the applicant, right? So you just have this provision in your zoning for what's called reserve parking. And you say, fine, we won't make you build it for a year. And we'll keep an eye on it. And if you don't really need that stuff for parking, turn it into a playground.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds interesting.
I think along the way, Judy, I'm hearing that there's things that are outside of the scope of this, but like this idea of the parking, you know, standards, even if you could think or recall a community that you thought had decent regulations and give us a reference to that, point us to a community that you think might have a good like parking standard. That might give, I think what Councillor Peake's looking for is like a potentially a model or at least a starting point for us.
That might take me more time than just rewriting what you have.
Fair enough. I had a quick question before Judy has to leave, and while we have two city councilors on the call, Judy, can you try to give us a brief explanation of, you'll make some revisions, you'll add a table of action items, and we'll get some stuff from Dotson, but you know, what do you envision the meeting with city council looking like? We had talked about potentially going for like December 16th. And, you know, where I keep getting hung up is whether it needs to be advertised as a public hearing or whether it's a presentation. And then if you can just describe like what you understand the city council's action to be. Just because we're getting very close, I think, to be moving this to city council for their approval. And I say that in air quotes, because I think that's where it's a little bit unclear the action that city council would be taking.
So it doesn't have to be a public hearing. What DHCD requires is that the planning board and the council approve the plan. And when it is submitted to the state, actually, technically, they say the planning board and the board of selectmen or mayor. But in every city I've worked in, the city council is reviewing the plan and acting on it. So both boards review and approve. And then a letter has to go to DHCD, signed by the mayor, saying that the city has adopted the plan by vote of the city council on X date and the planning board on Y date. Because they want evidence from the chief elected official that the plan has been reviewed and approved by those two entities. So that's really all that's required once you've heard the plan.
Okay. It's the word approved that is, I think that's the word approved, which gets challenging to understand the nature of what they're approving. So it's the general set of goals, the understanding that there are, identified potential sites. It's not to suggest that the sites listed, automatically mean they're going to be developed in any certain way. It's just the, it's an attempt to meet those requirements of DHCD. Okay.
Right. No one's going to penalize you if you have four sites listed that are ideal for a comprehensive permit or something. And then a developer comes along with a different site for the comprehensive permit that maybe you love, and it just makes its way through the ZBA, and somehow that gets you certified. Nobody's going to penalize you because it's not one of those four sites. The goal is to get the housing produced. That's the sort of interest of the act. That's the interest of the housing production plan.
So Judy,
ahead, Tom.
Sorry, Janet, just to follow up on Jeff's point, is December 16th to the city council a reasonable time frame?
It is. My anxiety is what time. Do we know? What time does the city council normally meet?
Generally something like, 6 p.m. I mean,
that would be great.
I don't have the authority at the moment to say that that's the right date. The planning board part, that might be, I will admit that I think it's a little bit of an oversight on my part that I did not call their attention to this meeting, which I probably should have, to have them have this opportunity to ask questions. So I may need to circle back to them and encourage them to watch at least this video and review the plan before they'll feel prepared to, approve it. Have you ever seen communities do a joint meeting?
Usually they do.
Right. We had we had our first joint public hearing with city council and planning board for a 121A application recently. And so everyone seemed to love it. Maybe we'll try to do something along those lines. But yeah, that's the part now at this moment that I think I need to take a little time to bring the planning board up to speed a little faster to match maybe December 16th. If not the 16th of December, it'd probably be that some meeting in January.
So the 16th would be fine for me as long as you can take me up first, because I have a public hearing at 7:30 that night. Or 7:15. I'll get back to you, Jeff. Let me check the timing of the public hearing. But I'm available at 6 and I'd be happy to do it.
And Jeff, we don't currently have anything from a public hearing perspective planned for December 16th. So not that this is a public hearing, but we have a lot of free time in that particular meeting right at this moment.
Wow. Okay. President Conniff, can I ask you a question? So, and I'm sorry, this is a little bit of logistical questions, but the process for council is to receive a document or an item and refer it to a committee. This is the part where I think you and I, when we were talking about this early on, is it was a little bit unclear whether this would be subject to some variation of that process or not. And I don't know how to handle that, so I'm asking you.
And maybe this is a Judy question, but specifically when you talk about approval from the planning board and from city council, are we approving this plan for the city. There's no money to be allocated. There's all we're all the city council is saying is that we are aligned and we approve with this plan. Go forth and make it so.
Yes. It is a go forth and make it so.
But we would not be sitting there and making adjustments or amendments or changes to it. We're just either we like it or we don't. That's it. And we give our opinion.
Yes, that's correct.
All right. Honestly, Jeff, I think a dual meeting with the planning board probably makes a lot of sense. I think, you know, I worry when we put these things right before city council, because this is pretty dense in terms of information, that I don't see all nine of us feeling comfortable to vote on this the same night we're reviewing it.
Right.
So maybe putting it to a committee where we can review it and then bring it back with comments and recommendations and other things might be a good idea. Is there a problem if it goes beyond December?
Not for me. I don't know about you. I don't even remember what the contract ended
is. You're so accommodating, Judy. Nothing's a problem. Everything's fine.
I think we're looking to outward. I think we want to be done with the project overall if possible by June. I mean, I think we want to, like you heard some questions about the accessory dwelling unit and the sense of readiness for that. So we don't want to elongate that part. But I think generally speaking, we have until June is where we would end with the contract.
I should just tell all of you that the pandemic has made me a remarkably patient person. And I didn't used to be this way, but I have learned the hard way.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you know, we're
in a different world now.
We can target the 16th. I just don't want to feel rushed about this because it's a pretty intense document. And right. I would like all of the city councilors to be kind of invested and excited about it. And they're going to have to dive into it for that to happen. So my feeling is if we can get it to a subcommittee, have those conversations, it might take two conversations in subcommittee before we bring it back. I don't know, Tom, what do you think about that?
I mean, so let me just make sure I understand what you're, so are we talking about whether or not to send it to committee?
Do we, just because of the density of the information, I don't feel comfortable bringing it straight to city council and just say, here it is, isn't it awesome, let's vote.
So was that what, like ordinance or, I mean,
well, which committee, we don't know yet.
I think we should send it to a committee because I don't realistically think we're going to get nine city councilors to in-depth read. How long of a document is this?
80-something pages.
I've read about half of it so far, and I sort of skipped to the back half because that's where the recommendations are. But like, I think it is like, I do think that it makes sense to have, at least a third of the council be accountable for really reading and vetting and understanding the whole thing. So yeah, it should probably go to a committee.
Okay.
I think that's helpful. It's really helpful for me is kind of just if I'm going to try to move and facilitate it. I think what I'm hearing, and there was a note from Jackie that the housing partnership did it as a presentation to council and the public. So, you know, the partnership plays a really important role in this as well. What I'm hearing is maybe if we set our sights on the first meeting in January and we could introduce it within the next sort of, if we introduced it sometime in December, you know, that even with the holidays and that kind of thing, that's kind of probably stretching it for a subcommittee to review it and then come back. But I think Councillor Conniff, that December 16th is that the 121A got continued to that meeting. So there is something, you know, the interesting part would, you know, there's a couple bulky things that the council has, the zoning amendment and the 121A. So if that's a target, we could look at introducing it at the first meeting in December, and because Judy's going to have to make some revisions and then introduce it the first meeting in December and allow December for time for the subcommittees and the planning board to look at it. And then, you know, some meeting in January to come for a vote to approve. Maybe that's the outline of a strategy to do this.
So my only request would be, as soon as you know what that January date might be, can you tell me? Because my life is insane.
I can tell you it would be one of these two dates. It will either be January 6th or January 20th.
Okay.
probably the 20th. But
yeah, I think the 20th would be easier to just set our sights on that, because the series of holidays in November, December are going to definitely throw some things off.
Yeah, I agree.
Tom, do you think that makes okay sense?
Yeah, I mean, I'm chomping at the bit to get the stuff done, but suppose we get January 20th is fine.
I'm putting you in my calendar now so nobody else grabs that date.
I think that
I'm also going to make a strong pitch that this go to rules and government relations, since this is in fact a document that we send to the state and the government relations, but we can figure that out internally.
I was just going to say, it also then, you know, gives the housing partnership the opportunity to go to that that committee meeting, that subcommittee meeting of the city council to talk, you know, absolutely, answer questions, talk about, you know, the previous plan, talk about what this is. And so,
yeah, good idea.
Just to counter that really politely, I just wonder if like, ordinance would have an important role moving forward almost immediately, you know, depending on the next steps and an ADU bylaw and changes that would come forward too. So there would be some value potentially having ordinance be aware of some of the, like the kind of like how you see probably the immediate next steps.
Yep.
Right. Well, you know, that's one thing that I'm wondering is just looking at this, you know, Jeff, we can talk offline about this in more detail, but personally, my schedule in terms of like things that I am getting through council is about to, sort of, you know, ease up. So, you know, once you guys have an amended thing, like I personally don't think that I need to wait until this has been approved to actually start moving on some of those suggestions. We could have obviously done those at any point. So I might be able to get some of these into ordinance by early December, regardless of when we meet to approve this plan to send to the state.
Sure. And I think it makes sense now. And that was what our early discussions were, is now there's going to be this document which will give the backup and the direction to be moving on certain things. So if you're looking at certain districts or certain changes, then yeah, now we know the document is going to support those concepts as well. So I think that's going to be really helpful.
Great. Well, we've given you 11 minutes to spare, Judy, till your next meeting.
Yeah, I probably should go. Do you need anything else from me tonight, though? Because otherwise I'm going to get off this Zoom and go on another Zoom. Just Zoom through the day.
Thank you again. I personally think it's a fabulous document.
Oh, thank you.
And thank coming you. From someone who's not from the area, too, it's fabulous.
Thank you.
Thank you, Judy. Much appreciated.
Yeah, thank you, Judy.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you.
Talk to Jeff and Jamie and work out some details with this, and we'll be back in touch. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Thank you, Judy.
After your meeting.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
And I just want to add before everyone leaves, if you had any more specific comments or concerns or questions, things you wanted related, if you email them to me or Jeff, you know, we can get them to Judy in advance of that next draft.
All right. And housing partnership, don't all hang up. So I think we just lost Kate, which I...
I'll text. Oh.
Okay.
All right. Well, I want to thank Jana and the committee for pushing this forward, and Tom and Councillor Conniff for joining and everyone. So I appreciate it. And it sounds like there'll be a little bit of revisions coming forward and then some scheduling matters to, you know, I can reach out and we can come up with the actual schedule for how this would work.
Great. Thank I think it's guys. Great.
It was wonderful.
Thank you. Thank you for joining us.
All right. Thanks, everybody. Have a good night.
Thank you.
All right. Don't hang up, Housing Partnership.
Jana, is that your polite way of saying everyone get out?
Yeah. No, you can hang. If you would like to stay on the meeting and talk about minutes, that's totally fine.
I'm just kidding. Have a good night, everyone. Thank you.
Bye, Chris.
Bye, Chris. And I just, Kate's going to come back.
Okay. Great. I don't have too many more things, but I.
Well, we had a whole agenda.
Well, we have other agendas. Yeah, other items, yes.
That's right.
Hi, Yoshi. Welcome. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
I'm super excited. The thing that I love about this version of the housing production plan that I think is different, and I think it's partly just because Judy is such a housing person, is that I feel like it gives a lot more context to like why we're doing it and what it means. And I just think it... I felt like I liked the last one too, but I did feel like it was more like, here's all the data. mm-hmm. here's all the stuff to do. And this, I felt like Judy did a really nice job, like making it much more in context. So I think it's great. Mm-hmm. All right, I only have two other items. One is the September meeting notes that I emailed out. Did everybody have a chance to look at them?
Yes. I wrote them, so.
Yeah. And they
studying them with such detail. No, we can make a motion.
Can we make a motion to approve them so I can send them to Barbara?
I think Kate just did, and I'll second.
All those in favor?
Yep.
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. I'm missing the October notes.
You know, they're almost done, and I will send them to you.
Thank you.
That's my fault. My bad.
That's all right. Thank you. I have one more thing. Does anyone else have anything else that they want to talk about?
Ashley Grant may also like to rejoin the partnership.
Okay. That'd be great.
That would be great.
Yes. Well, I think I'm tired tonight, but I really do think actually we have a lot of work that we could do based on this document.
Yes.
I mean, we could do like a lot of stuff. Yeah.
I was excited about Judy's recommendation that we look more closely at the CHAPA Municipal Engagement Program, mm-hmm. because I think that it is, we've been talking about this for a while, and I think that that might give us like the push to actually do it. And I feel like I looked at it once before, and for some reason I felt like maybe, I don't know, we weren't eligible for some reason, but so maybe thinking about doing it collaboratively. I don't know about Northampton. I feel like they're like some ways like light years ahead of we are, but and Southampton is like way back here, but I think we should really look at it, because I think it would really be the push that we need to get that going. So I thought that was a great suggestion. Yes, I do think there's a lot we could do, but I would like her to come up with like a little bit more of a detailed list, because I think that that will be helpful to us.
Yeah.
The only other thing that I wanted to mention, so our next meeting is on December 10th. We usually have a holiday party for our December meeting, which I guess we won't do. You can all eat cookies at home instead of together, which is what we normally do.
You can have a cocktail, I guess, instead of doing it in the office.
Because we don't do that when we meet in person. Or apple cider. But I...
It dawned on me, you know, I've been the chair of the Housing Partnership for a really,
really long time. And, which is fine. I love doing it. But if we have some new members, if there is anyone who is interested in being the chair, you know, I think we should talk about it in December. You know, basically my job is to get the meeting agenda to Barbara on time, which I nearly failed this month. So thankfully it's not a big deal. And make sure that she gets the meeting notes and basically facilitate the meeting. And sometimes talk to Jeff and Jamie outside of our regular meeting about things. Show up when we need to speak at public meetings, which most of the rest of you do anyway. So anyway, I just, you know, we used to have we don't have term limits because we're not that fancy. And if Jackie recalls, there used to be a time where like every 2 years, I would say, who wants to be the chair? And everyone would say, no one. And then I would keep doing it. But I haven't done that in a really long time. And so I just, you know, like, let think about it. If anyone's interested, we could talk about it in December. You know,
I will tell you this, Jana, down the line, I could be interested in it, but not right now. Would you guys like to meet the newest member of my family?
Yes.
This is Jonah, who was there the whole meeting. But down the line, Jana, someday I will take over. If no one else wants it, I will be the chair. Today is just not the day.
There's a baby in your house.
Yeah, there's a baby. There was a baby in my belly for like 9 months too. And you guys just didn't see it because it was...
We didn't even know. We didn't even see you.
Jackie knows because she's on my Instagram post. So, yeah, Jackie's been following Jonah for a long time. So I'm just introducing you to it. I would, if he wasn't sleeping, I'd hold him up and say, it's the circle of life. But, you know, he was been sleeping this whole meeting.
So, what if,
congratulations.
Since Ken's not here.
True.
We
nominate him. I love it. I love it.
I think
everyone touched their nose.
Yeah. I'm just kidding.
I do have a question though about term limits. And
yeah.
So when I was approved, I didn't realize this, but I was finishing up like an interim type role. And then I got a letter in the mail from Nicole to ask me if, you know, I'm still interested. Okay. So I don't know if there's like a lapse in my membership happening right now or when the new term starts.
The terms are, and they, all the city's boards and committee appointments, everything ends December 31st, okay, of whichever year. If you've responded that you want to be reappointed, you'll be put on a list and the city council will make, will usually deal with that in their December meeting.
Okay.
So there was a response deadline in that letter. And so provided you got it to them in the response deadline, you'll be added to that list. And it's okay, pretty much like, unless you did something really horrid, those reappointments go through,
okay,
basically without question. All so right, then you'll be reappointed for the full 3-year term.
Okay, great. I just wanted to make sure that there was no like I'm like agreeing to minutes when I shouldn't be or anything like that. So, okay.
I'm surprised you were filling an interim seat. I'm so confused about, like, I thought we didn't have a minimum number or a maximum number. And then there's posts that we have vacancies. I'm like, well, I mean, that's fine. We have vacancies, but we also don't. We used to try to always have 9 members and we never had 9 members. It was like a disaster. So, but.
Is Yoshi interested in joining?
Yes, I was going to ask if there was like a formal system for that.
Sorry, I'm still bad at I'm terrible at Zoom. So sometimes I forget to look to see if someone's still on there. I just see the like 4 people there and I was like, oh, okay. There I know your name from somewhere, and I'm not sure from where, but I feel like you're famous.
Yoshi,
I've heard your name before.
Yoshi is famous.
Infamous.
That's right.
Yoshi is going to, like, whip us into shape with all of her data analysis, like, expertise. I used to be in meetings with Yoshi, and it was like, she was really...
Oh, my God. Manager expectations. That was my 30s.
Where do you work? You do sound familiar to me. Where do you work?
I work right now down in Hartford at South Park Inn, which is a homelessness services agency. We do shelter, transitional housing, veteran services, and permanent housing. But I used to work for most of my career for the Center for Human Development, where I oversaw the diversion housing. Oh, there's my cat. Stabilization program, which is about $15 million of shelter and diversion and other sorts of homelessness services.
Did you follow Jane Banks down to Hartford?
Yes. Jane and I, we're a pair. We go everywhere together.
Did you follow her to DHCD too? And then you followed her down?
No, I went to the YWCA of Western Mass for 2 years. And then I was like, I got to get back to Jane. She's the best. So, and yeah, so that I know Jana from the Western Mass Network and homelessness.
Got it. Okay. That's where your name must be familiar. I used to do like housing stuff in, but not enough, not deeply enough, not like you and Jana, but.
I feel like Kate is also sort of famous because when you were the director of the Franklin Housing, the Court Service Center, right? Wasn't that you? You were like pretty famous.
Oh yeah. In Franklin County, I was like, everyone was like, oh my God, I need to talk to you.
Yeah.
But now I'm just at DMH and everyone's like, I don't know who you are.
Well, we do, and it's all good.
We are a very lucky crew that we have a lot of expertise. Brad also has a housing and background, right? Yeah. So, I mean, we're a very lucky group because we have a lot of expertise that we bring. So, we're pretty awesome. So Yoshi, there is an application on the city website that you fill out, right, Jamie? And you submit to the mayor's office.
Yep.
And then you basically get appointed, as far as I can. It's not scary.
There might be an interview or phone call with you and the mayor before she forwards your name to the appointments subcommittee.
Sounds good. I haven't done anything horrible.
Yeah.
Jana, for next meeting, are we going to party or are we going to go through this and kind of set our agenda items? That's the other reason why you don't want me to be the chair. Let me be clear. I'm like the chair of a couple of things at work and no one ever wants it because I'm like really a hard worker. I'm like, let's do this thing. If I have no responsibilities, then I just chitter chatter.
I feel like since we're not going to be in person, we don't really need to have a party because that feels like not the best use of our time. I mean, I'm sure you all have other things you'd rather do. But I would, I don't know, what will we talk about? We could talk about the housing production plan a little bit more. By then, maybe we'll have seen Judy's revisions, I'm hoping, if she's planning to go to the city council on the 12th. I think that it will be important for us to attend the city council meeting, if it goes to subcommittee, to attend that subcommittee meeting. So we could talk about like what our strategies would be just to help the city councilors understand what the heck this plan is for. And, you know, it could give us a chance to read the document again and digest it a little bit. I know we didn't give you a ton of time to read 82 pages before tonight. So you could have a little bit more time with the document and we could think about, we could think more about the municipal engagement program. We could think about more about what are the things that we think are the most important that the housing partnership wants to work on.
If that all sounds good, we could just kind of have a conversation about those things.
Yeah, I mean, I was thinking also one of the more short-term things is really the city council. I mean, even when you make a comment, though we'd like to think that everybody's going to read it really in depth, they're not. And so when you summarize the most important things, so do we want to emphasize the families? Do we want to emphasize the single, you know, so I think that we could maybe talk about that too and how we want to summarize and present to the city council or the subcommittee of the city council.
It seemed to me that Judy was planning to give a presentation to the council. And so I don't know, in the past, you know, the housing partnership was really involved in making that presentation and the outreach. But I think, you know, just from the conversation tonight, it seemed like Judy was preparing to do all that.
But I think it's helpful because, you know, frankly, I don't want the council to forget that we exist and that our role in this community is to help increase and maintain affordable housing in the community. So I think even if Judy is giving that presentation, like we're the people on the ground who are going to be trying to advocate for this and work through different issues. And I think it's helpful for us to be there to remind the city council that that's what we do.
Yep. Okay.
We could pull out a couple salient pieces. I know I'm just going for it. Because I do think even when you ask your very innocuous question, you're focusing people on a very specific thing. You're like, so we can also pull out the things that we're most interested in and, you know, and just highlight it.
Okay. Yeah. And I don't think that I didn't get the impression that Judy would go to the subcommittee meetings. And so I do think you know, I feel like we're the local people to be like, this is what this is, and this is why it's important. So we could talk about some strategy for that. I feel like the city council members are going to be mostly on board with this. It's pretty not
controversial. So this is a question that I was wondering about. The difference, and it's just a really a nerdy language question. So does the city council need to approve it or accept it? Because I feel like accepting it makes more sense because that means it's a plan that we are working on as opposed to approve it like this is what we're doing. So that was a question that occurred to me while we were talking. And maybe it's just a semantic sort of
question. So the regulations say the housing production plan shall be adopted by the municipality's planning board, conservation commission, and its select board or city council.
Okay, so that's the language then is adopted. So we should make sure that
That's
but we're not bringing it to the Conservation Commission. But the language explicitly says conservation.
Maybe that's a clarification that we need from Judy. We definitely didn't bring it to the Conservation Commission last time.
Yeah.
Okay, Kate.
I gotta run, guys. No, that was my. I gotta run.
Okay. Yeah, I think we're done. Right? Everyone feels good. All right. So we'll meet again on the 10th and go from there.
Cool.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye, guys.
Okay, bye. Congratulations, Kate. Oh, she hung up. Okay. Bye.
Night.